Also ich möchte Sie dann herzlich begrüßen zu diesem Kolloquium. Ich werde gar nicht so viel zu den Vortragenden sagen, weil ich nämlich Professor Wolfgang Palaver gebeten habe, diese Sitzung heute zu moderieren. Und nur ganz kurz, also diese Veranstaltung gehört zu dem Projekt Postsecular Conflicts, das ein Institut für Soziologie läuft und betrifft eigentlich ganz genau schon den Kern dessen, was wir in diesem Projekt erforschen wollen, und zwar transnationale Wertedebatten, die Russland, Europa und die USA umspannen und die Dynamiken, die da dahinter stecken, politisch auf der Seite der Zivilgesellschaft und auch auf der Seite einer politischen Philosophie, also die Frage, wohin bewegen sich eigentlich unsere Gesellschaften. Das ist das Projekt, und wir haben immer wieder Veranstaltungen, zu denen wir Personen einladen, die uns bei diesen Fragen weiterhelfen können, und diese Veranstaltung ist auch eine solche. Und ja, ich freue mich, dass Sie gekommen sind, dass Sie die Zeit gefunden haben, und gebe dann auch schon das Wort an Wolfgang. Danke.
Okay, thank you very much, first of all, for inviting me to share this interesting and exciting discussion, I expect at least, and it's an important topic, an important theme. What we will do tonight is religion and politics in and across Russia, Ukraine and the United States as part of this serious colloquium, Post-Secular Conflicts, and I'm very happy to introduce shortly to you our three speakers coming from all over the world, more or less. And then afterwards I will just tell you the basic rules of what we are going to do, so that you know the rules and they again hear the rules and hopefully follow the rules. And then I think we can have a quite inspiring discussion. I will just introduce the speakers in the way they sit here. So the first speaker is Cyril Hovrun. He earned his BA in Theology from Kiev Theological Academy, so he's coming from Ukrainian background, and studied also in Athens National University. His PhD is in Theology from Durham University in the United Kingdom. He holds a permanent position of senior lecturer at Sankt Ignatius Theological Academy, part of the Stockholm School of Theology in Sweden. He has published quite a lot of books: Meta-Ecclesiology, Chronicles on Church Awareness, Will, Action and Freedom, Christological Controversies in the 17th Century, From Antioch to Xi'an, An Evolution of Nestorianism, and this was published in English and Chinese, so as I told you, what we are doing is in some way a global thing. Curiosities of the Great and Awful Council in Russian, and he is the co-editor of the Orthodox Handbook on Ecumenism, Resources for Theological Education. So we are very happy and grateful to have you with us. Our second speaker is now coming from an other continent, not from Europe, but from America, from the United States, specifically from New York, from the Big Apple. Our speaker is Russell Reno. When you buy a book of him, it's R.R. Reno, and you have to figure out what the R's mean. He's called by his friends, and I think we can deal with you as friends, right, tonight. He's called Rusty Reno. He got his PhD in 1990 from Yale University in the Department of Religious Studies. His dissertation was Seeking Priorities, the Individual in Community. He was later on teaching as a professor of theology at Creighton University, one of the Jesuit-based universities in the United States. And since 2011, he is a very influential public thinker, and he calls himself journalist. I think that's not the proper term for what he's doing. He's one of the influential Christian thinkers, I would say, and public thinkers. As an editor of a monthly Christian magazine called First Things, which has quite an influence, at least in Christian, Protestant, and Catholic, and Orthodox circles, I suppose. Is that roughly?
Judaism also. Judaism. We do stuff on Judaism.
Ah, and Judaism, yeah.
We publish some Muslim authors.
Yeah. Okay, that was our second speaker, and last but not least, our third speaker, who is now coming from Russia. I mean, not today, but from his upbringing. Our third speaker is Sergei Chapnin. And Chapnin, right? Sergei Chapnin. And he has a master in journalism and communication science from Moscow State University in 1993. Was a chief editor, so also one of those people who influenced the public life of the official magazine of the Russian Orthodox Church, the Journal of the Moscow Patriarchate, and the official newspaper, the Church Herald. He also served as a senior lecturer at the Theological Faculty of the Saint-Tichon Orthodox University, was a secretary of the Commission on Church, State and Society of the Interconciliar Board of the Russian Orthodox Church, and a deputy chief editor of the publishing house of the Moscow Patriarchate. He organized many national and international events for the church, including a biannual festival of Orthodox media and exhibitions of contemporary Christian art and architecture. He also published a book with the title The Church in Post-Soviet Russia, and another book, Revival, Quality of Faith, Dialogue with the Society. Oh, that's the subtitle probably. And that was published in Russian in 2013. So I think our panel is just the best panel you can get for a discussion on religion and politics across Russia, Ukraine, and the United States. At least all those three countries are present among us. So our panel is asked to answer four questions, or at least, if they need a little bit more time, for just two questions, at least two questions. And the questions we want to address are the following. First, how does religion influence politics? So the view from religion to politics. Second, how do politics influence religion from the other side? The third question, what are the consequences of religion-state relations for the religions themselves? Where do the religious believers, the so-called grassroots people, stand? And the fourth question, which is a required question, as I understand the rules, the fourth question addresses the international situation and the way in which religion determines relationships between Russia, Ukraine, and the US. And I myself, and I think all of us here, are looking forward, and I think we just move forward in the same order. And if you, Cyril, please start, give us a start.
Well, thank you. I'll try to answer all these questions, and just stop me when I will be of my time. Speaking about the influence of religion on politics and of politics upon religion, I think in the modern setting we need to distinguish between two things: the words and the deeds, the rhetoric and the policies. As regards the influence of religion upon politics, I think it is mostly a linguistic influence, that the religion, churches, provide politicians with a language, with vocabulary, with wording. And the politicians nowadays in the present situation are happy to adopt some terms, some phrases from religion. It doesn't mean that they apply those phrases in their policies. What happens sometimes, I think, is just the opposite. The moment that the politicians embark on the religious language, they begin sometimes abusing that language and begin applying even more severe policies than if they were using the secular language. It's a syndrome, I call this syndrome sacred corruption. It happens when, say, on a local level, a level of a parish, imagine a small community somewhere in the nowhere of the Eastern Europe, a priest is approached by a local criminal, a gangster, and a conversation begins, and the gangster comes with anxiousness. He's anxious about what he has done, and because the parish is developing, it needs some money, you know, gangsters immediately figures out and provides some help, and the priest, through the conversation, gives some sort of relief, which sometimes leads to relieving the gangster from the bad consciousness, but also enabling him to do some even worse things. That's how corruption develops, evolves in the societies like Ukraine, Russia, Belarus, and so forth. On the macro level, the same happens in politics, I think, sometimes. When the politicians adopt the language of religion, they feel emboldened to behave more cruelly. I would exemplify this with the case of my own country. The moment that the Russian president adopted the language which was provided by the church, the language of the Russian world, traditional values, religious revival, and so forth, soon after that, the aggression against my country started. The Crimea was annexed, the war in the east of Ukraine began, and all those aggressions were garnished with a very rich religious rhetoric. Essentially, the rhetoric of the Russian world was religious. And the ideology which emboldened, which drove the aggression was provided by the church, unfortunately. The same happened for instance, in Syria. Soon after the Russian intervention to Syria was declared by the church authorities as a sacred war, the atrocity of Aleppo happened. So I see a connectedness between the politicians adopting religious language and the war crimes that they commit. That's why I like politicians to speak secular language. It is safer for the world. I know it goes against the idea about re-enchantment of politics, but I think re-enchantment sometimes is can lead to such consequences. Let me put this in terms, in the sociological terms, since we in the setting of the Institute of Sociology. The sociologists of religion, they have developed two basic concepts, I think, which fit, I think, the situations that I've just described. The concept of the civil religion and political religion. The concept of the political religion, politische Religion, was developed in the pre-war Germany by people like Fergelin, and it actually described the situation of Nazis Germany and of communist regimes that expressed themselves in religious terms. They made people subscribing to themselves as to a sort of quasi-religion. Soon after that, the concept was transmitted through people like Fergelin again, like Tillich, to the United States. And in the United States, other post-war generation of sociologists like Robert Miller continue this line and develop a concept of civil religion, which is not a new term. It was coined by Jean-Jacques Rousseau in the French context, but it was revitalized somehow in the United States in the American context, and began describing the American political culture, which had began in with the beginning of the American project, actually in the 18th century. And this civil religion, this concept of civil religion, became descriptive, a successful descriptive concept for the American political culture. Even though there is a genetic relatedness between the concept of the political religion and civil religion, they are quite different. I find the difference between them in the way how they treat human freedom. Political religion is coercive. It rides on violence. It forces people to subscribe to the political religion, like Nazism or communism or whatever. Civil religion is non-violent. It uses different instruments of subscribing, like persuasion, like sometimes manipulation, yes, but never violence. And that is a radical difference between the European political religion and American civil religion. All these concepts very densely worked in Russia, in the post-communist Russia. I think the civil religion, a Russian civil religion, began was introduced during the 2000s. The reason, rationale why it was introduced, was to increase legitimacy. A feature of the civil religion is that it is capable of increasing legitimacy when convenient mechanisms of providing legitimacy don't work properly. This happened after the elections to the State Duma, to the Russian Parliament, which were doubted as falsified, and during the exchange of power between Putin and Medvedev, before the third term of Putin. Then the legitimacy of Russian power actually decreased, and a civil religion was in demand. That's how the church felt this and began providing civil religion discourse to the Russian political regime. At that time, it was really a civil religion. It was not coercive. It was kind of optional. But soon, a transformation from the civil religion to political religion happened, and I see as a turning point in this transformation the episode with Pussy Riot punk group. As you remember, there was a punk group of girls, feminist group, which performed in the cathedral of the Russian Church in Moscow, Christ the Savior Cathedral, and as a result, under the pressure from the church, on the request of the church, they were sentenced to 2 years in prison. This was a coercive act, which I believe transformed the initial Russian civil religion into a political religion, a coercive one. And since then, the political religion has replaced civil religion, became really violent. And the culmination of this political religion became the aggression in Ukraine. So I see a connectedness between the Pussy Riot episode and the Russian war in Ukraine. The same idea of applying violence to make someone to subscribe to the values, to the ideas of the political religion. In the case of Pussy Riot, 2 years in prison. In the case of Ukraine, artillery, snipers, and so forth. I'm not supposed to talk about Russia, I'm supposed to talk about Ukraine. A few words about Ukraine. I will, 3 minutes. I will try to be concise.
So that's the international, is that the...
We're talking about Ukraine now. Yeah.
Yes, I'm talking about Ukraine, the fourth point. I think we can interpret the developments in Ukraine in the terms of civil religion as well. Civil and political religion. The conflict in Ukraine is essentially the conflict between the neo-imperial project run by Russia and the project of independent national state from the Ukrainian side. You can interpret the Russian world as a political religion which came as an aggression to Ukraine. You can interpret the resistance to that as a civil religion of nationalism. There is a sort of nationalism, certainly. But I would not say that it was only nationalism, because the Maidan, the revolutionary dignity that happened in the winter 2013-14, was a civil sort of nationalism. It was a national nationalism, but it was a nationalist which wrote on the civil values, values of dignity, equal for everyone, for any nation. And this was also blessed by the church somehow. So it was a third type of civil religion, which was really civil, not national. Just one word for last minute about the American situation. So for stealing your bread. But I think the two concepts are applicable to the American situation nowadays. Historically, civil religion is an American phenomenon. First, the American civil religion was described by sociologists. Now, with the undermined legitimacy of the with the new president, which has been doubted by media and so forth, I envisage a rise of civil religion in America, because there will be a demand for new legitimization, for increasing legitimization of the new regime, new political party, new administration. But what may happen is a transformation, and I would like to warn this, I don't want this to happen, but this may happen nowadays, a transformation of civil American civil religion to an American political religion. This may happen. And this will be a re-enchantment of the American political scene. It's a bad scenario, I know, but I think it is possible nowadays. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for this clear thesis. I think it's a very clear thesis, very good for our discussion and for the exchange, and also for keeping the time limit and keeping the rules perfectly. So we move over to Rusty Reno.
All Americans are rule breakers. So you better
watch
out.
But I am a cat echon. That means we tame you in. Okay, Rusty, same rules.
Well, when you talk about religion in the United States, you're really talking about Christianity. Judaism has attained a kind of a legitimate voice since 1945. Mormonism plays a kind of important role in some respects. But when it's all said and done, Christianity is the 900-pound gorilla in American politics. And so I'm going to speak primarily about Christianity in the American context. Historically, it's a kind of establishmentarian Protestantism that has shaped American society most thoroughly. It led the charge against slavery in the early 19th century and succeeded in prohibiting the sale of alcohol for 20 years in the early 20th century. Those were both projects of establishment Protestantism. Catholicism exercised a great deal of power in the early 20th century in urban ethnic strongholds. But by and large, it's establishment Protestantism that's plays the most important role in American politics. And one of the most important changes in American society has been the collapse of this establishment Protestantism as a vital Christian church phenomenon. But that does not mean that it has died as a public influence. Our progressivism in America is strongly, is dominated by what I call a kind of post-Christian moralism. And that, you know, it seems to me that the children and the grandchildren of the people who, well, the great-grandchildren and the great-great-grandchildren of the people who brought us prohibition are now leading the charge in environmentalism, gay rights, and also feminism. I think it's fair to say that, that it's the same group. Catholicism is now post-ethnic in the United States, and the Catholic Church is kind of ambivalent about what its role is in American politics. By and large, it's still this sort of Americanized ethnic church from the early 20th century. I think Pope Francis's refusal to make Archbishop Gomez in Los Angeles a cardinal indicates how purely subordinate the status of Hispanics are in the American Catholic Church. still an Irish and German church, by and large, dominant church in the United States. But I think Catholicism is pretty politically disoriented in the current situation. There's a kind of war in the Catholic Church between an older generation that remains loyal to the Democratic Party, which used to be the ethnic party from an earlier era, and younger Catholics tend to be more politically conservative, and it's so there's a, I think Catholic Church in the United States is it has an ambivalent role. Over the last generation, as everybody I think who follows politics in America knows, that conservative Protestants, or what we call in the United States evangelicals, have become very powerful as a political force. A lot's been written about that. Many younger evangelicals are unhappy with this strong political role. But in the last election, the election of Donald Trump, evangelicals voted for Trump in really historically high numbers, I mean, overwhelming numbers. And it's interesting that what I call the sort of post-Protestant establishment group is the if you count them as a certain religious group, let's call them people with no religious affiliations, they vote Democrat with as much intensity as conservative evangelicals vote Republican. So there's kind of a collision between a certain kind of post-Christian moralism and conservative Protestantism. It's not surprising that the Protestant conservative Protestantism is so politically engaged. In America, conservative Protestantism is a populist religion. It's got the closest connections to the democratic age of any form of Christianity because it emerged in the early modern period. And this is why conservative Protestants typically fuse together American politics and theology. And they tend to speak about my own country in as a kind of a church, that America is a kind of a church. Like I say, it's not surprising because this kind of conservative Protestantism is intimately linked with the modern democratic political project, not just in the United States, but in England and elsewhere. So in sum, it seems to me that politics and religion have always been deeply intertwined, and that in the United States, more so than perhaps elsewhere, we never had an anti-clerical liberalism in the United States, and we never had an atheistic socialist movement in the United States. Progressivism in America and conservatism in America have always been church-led phenomena. In fact, I think every significant political movement in America has been church-led until the last generation when this post-Protestant progressivism has taken over. Catholicism in this context is an exception. I think America remains a very Protestant-dominated political culture. Catholicism is on the outside, by and large, less invested in America as a messianic nation, although Catholics are Americans, so we think that way also. Catholic bishops largely sat out the last presidential election, kind of anxious and uncertain about what to do in that very fraught election. And so I think that we see that. Because of America's national project is so imbued with a spiritual ethos of a certain kind of Protestantism, faith is always at risk, I think, of being absorbed or swallowed up by politics. And I think post-Protestant progressivism is now an entirely political religion. So I think progressivism in America is not a civil religion, but in nuclear terminology, a political religion. Many conservative Protestants also have a political religion as they fuse Christianity with American conservatism. And I think your terminology is helpful in that regard. And again, I think Catholicism remains on the outside, though many Jesuits make progressive politics into a kind of religion. But there's something about the American ethos that makes it easy for Jesuits to do that in the United States. To the international situation, my final moments here. I think that we need to recognize that the most significant aspect of American foreign policy is the fusion of Enlightenment universalism with a Protestant messianic mentality. That these two things fuse together. That Christ came to convert all the nations and bring them to himself. And Enlightenment values are universal and for everyone. And the United States is both of those things. Therefore, the destiny of the world is to become like America. And we owe it to the entire world to Americanize the world. Because the natural condition of the human person is to be an American. And so if we strip away people's culture, they will become American by default, automatically. Of course, that was our conceit when we invaded Iraq. And so this messianic, we are a messianic nation, and bringing political salvation to the Gentiles. And this is a fundamental element of our national character, impossible to get rid of. It's noble in some respects. I think that my own country has done many good things for the world in the last 100 years, but it's also a very dangerous idea, a very dangerous sensibility. Now Russia, as far as I can tell, and I'm not learned enough to have more than just passing impressions, has a similar messianic sensibility. It's perhaps less global in its messianic vision, given the lack of this Enlightenment element, which is so powerfully active in our American combination of secular rights and religious zeal. So Russia's obviously quite different. That said, in many respects, we're both messianic nations. And this foretells a potential kind of quasi-religious collision between Russia and the United States, especially as Russia now competes for ideological and moral leadership in Europe, just where America, of course, has since 1945 presumed that we're the ones who provide moral and ideological leadership. So we can see this collision. And I think for those in America who interpret this as a kind of retro-Marxism in Moscow are mistaken. I think there's a deeper third Rome. There are deeper third Rome sources for this. Anyone who reads Vladimir Soloviev or Vladimir Lossky can see that Russian Orthodox-inspired culture aspires to save European culture from its legalistic and formalistic and mercantile tendencies. So therefore, I anticipate an intensifying struggle between Russia and the United States over Europe, and it will be cast in moral and spiritual terms. It's going to be open versus closed, democratic versus authoritarian, pluralist versus xenophobic. That's the American side talking. Or, this is the Russian side talking, it will be rooted versus abstract, moral versus antinomian, spiritual versus commercial, one committed to solidarity versus one committed to a kind of atomistic individualism. So my sense is that religion and politics are deeply intertwined, inextricably intertwined, for precisely the reason, Cyril, that you mentioned, which is that every society needs legitimacy. Religious language provides the most powerful source for legitimacy, and so it's with us whether we want to be or not. And so my sense is that in the international situation, these religious terms continue to loom large.
Okay, thank you very much, Rusty, for also a clear insight into the relationship between politics, religion, and the different denominations in the US, and your comment on similarities and also differences between the messianism in the United States and Russia. So, our third speaker, Sergei Chapnin.
Yes, thank you.
we now also have a chance to...
I would put my points in more historical perspective, not to sort of go into polemics with the with my colleagues. So I would start with the year 1988, when at that time communist regime in Soviet Union, which was still rather powerful. So communist authorities allowed Russian Orthodox Church to celebrate millennium of baptism of Russia. That was the starting point for the period that is now called the Church Revival. And lots of things happened during this now nearly 30 years. And it's important to see what were the stages in this spiritual revival and what we have now in Russia and other post-Soviet countries. So in the beginning, I would say approximately 8 to 10 years, the main problem was that the state authorities didn't really know at all how to deal with the church. So the church was suppressed, it was locked within its buildings and allowed only to, the priests were only allowed to celebrate the liturgy, and that's it. No social activities, no charitable activities, no mission, nothing outside the walls of the church. So no religious education. So when church started these activities, it started them on its own with no support and even no understanding from state officials of different levels. That continued approximately for 10 years. All the state officials were actually former Soviet bureaucrats, communist bureaucrats, so they have no idea what to do with the church. Later, the new generation of state bureaucracy and elite and politicians grew up, and they had a real problem what to do, because 90s were the years of poverty, of economic crisis, of political crisis, and people were tired of that. And for many, they were tired not of this economical or political clashes and problems, but they were tired with the idea of democracy in general. So by late 90s, Russia was sort of fed up with democracy and it was ready to get rid of it. So what then? What could replace democracy in Russian context? That was a very interesting question, because the only alternative was new empire. So whether Russia will develop as a new Russian empire, or find out something else. And the church really helped the state a lot to shape out the new version of Russian state as an empire, because that was the easiest way for the church. Church was the church of empire for centuries, and it was, I would say, happy to return to its sort of basic pattern, to be the church of empire. And that was the point that could be described also in terms of civil religion. And in fact, I would say, though this term was applied in mid 20th century in America, in fact, nearly the whole history of Orthodoxy, at least in Russia, could be described as a sort of different type, but anyway, the type of civil religion. And in post-Soviet context, it had new characteristics. But the main thing is that what we see as the core of the tradition, in what period of Russian history the true, the golden age of tradition was. And there were lots of discussions. And finally, everybody agreed that, in fact, the only tradition that we preserved was Soviet tradition, because the other traditions died out during the 70 years of communism in Russia. So it's a sort of hybrid, the Soviet tradition was melted with the restored elements of Christian tradition. And that gave certain strength to Russian state because there was no need in God, there was no need in Christ, but there's a lot of sort of rhetorics about patriotism, about Russian history, about the unity of the nation, about the divided nation and Russians and Slavs that were outside Russia, and that was called Russkii Mir, Russian world later. So this concepts were somehow religiously motivated, and I agree with Cyril on this point. Yet I think that the religious, the civil religion, in fact, started earlier. I would say with the article by Metropolitan Cyril, now Patriarch Cyril, in the year 2000, when he started to criticize liberalism. And that was, I would say, the starting point for the development of civil religion, the Orthodox version, the post-Soviet version of civil religion. That was on the level of the society. The political implementations were not clear. The politicians were not using religious rhetorics. But this general consensus that, that if you're Russian, you should be Orthodox, that was clear for the moment. But a few additional things should be included in this portrait of the Orthodox Christian in Russia. He should be definitely patriotic, and he should be loyal to the state. And in fact, patriotic and loyal to the state are synonyms in modern Russia. So next step was the usage of this concepts, the practical implementation of this concepts in political life. I agree that the case of Pussy Riot was one of the main points, and I will explain why, because my explanation is totally different from yours. We have lots of examples when Putin was using sort of religious, I would say not only rhetorics, but also concepts in his explanations of what he's doing as president. So what we have now, the political regime that we have in Russia could be described as hybrid regime, which means that it is, we have democratic procedures, we have elections, we have different branches of power, but nevertheless the regime in its essence is autocratic. So that means that the main task in Kremlin now is to keep sort of proper balance between the democratic forms and the autocratic essence. So the church is a very important tool today to keep this balance. And that means that the from the side of the state, the approach is very practical. So how the church can do that? That goes through divine sanction for power. We know that there are only three sort of types of sanction could be: democratic procedures, charismatic character of the leader, and divine sanction. So the church is responsible for providing this divine sanction for power. And until the year 2013, everything was extremely simple, and everybody were happy with that. State was sort of paying money for the church expenses, for restoration of the churches, for charitable projects, and so on. And the church was praying for the well-being and prosperity of the president and state powers, and so on. So everything was very good. It was a very good deal. What happened with Pussy Riot? So, and the Kremlin was absolutely sure that there were fixed words for prayer, and these words were all just well-being and prosperity. And that's it, nothing else. And suddenly, in the main cathedral of the Russian Orthodox Church, in the very center of Moscow, a few hundred meters from Kremlin, a few young women jumps into the ambo, and without any motives, without any visible or understandable argumentation, they started to pray in a very different way. The problem is not that they jumped into the ambo or danced on the ambo. This is the sort of the second thing. The first thing was that they were praying with their own words, saying, "Mother of God, cast away Putin." And that was a real problem for Kremlin, because they can't imagine that Orthodox Christians could pray with their own words using such a sort of with such an intention. That was really terrible, because, well, Putin, everything is under control within the country, and he expects that everything is under control within the church, and Patriarch is responsible for this control within the church. And suddenly, and that's sort of political propaganda in the religious context. That was absolutely new for this new Russian Empire. So,
could you now turn to the international question?
Yes,
maybe we can come back to Pussy Riot later.
All the forms of freedom were sort of shut up within the church after that. The hierarchical structure was enforced. So we don't have now the sort of the horizontal dimension of the church is rather small, but the vertical, the hierarchy got the full power now. So as for the international question, that means that because the attitude between the church and state are sort of very pragmatic, then the state is not really interested what the church is doing outside Russia, except the Ruski Mir, but the failed Ruski Mir activities. But now, because the state is using this rhetorics of traditional values, supported and actually in Russian context invented by the church, this is the basis for broader cooperation between conservative groups and actors in different countries. The most visible part is the pro-family and pro-life activities, but this is not the only level of this kind of activities. There are also small groups of radicals and religious conservatives that are involved in their own networks, surprisingly, there are no signs that a liberal religious network exists, whether within Russia or on the international level. So I'll stop this with a question, but I think it's rather interesting to discuss it.
Thank you again for a clear presentation of the situation of the relationship between religion and politics in Russia. I am chair, so I can do what I want, right, in some way, so I'm glad that I can do that, because I saw some similarities and also some differences, and maybe in the first round I will try to figure out where are the similarities and where are the differences, and then we can open up. But as I'm the chair, I want to clarify some questions that I felt are not completely clear to me. So I would like to start at the very end with the Pussy Riot, because in some way you said you don't see it in the same way, although I think in the consequences you probably agree. You more strongly emphasized the religious dimension of it, meaning that it was this different kind of, or praying outside the traditional forms of praying, that was the most disturbing thing, whereas you, as I understood, more focused on the political consequences, that they got imprisoned and connected to the shift from civil religion to political religion. And Rusty, not today, but yesterday, when Rusty gave a lecture at the Theological faculty in Innsbruck here, you also mentioned Pussy Riot, so that could be a first clarification just on this issue. I mean, it's also related to gender, to the distinction between male and female. I mean, Pussy Riot is a female riot, right? In some way, so it's related. Group. Yeah, it's a feminist group. So I already yesterday I thought maybe women, and we saw the reaction of Trump. So the most widespread protests in the United States now were protests by women. So maybe we can can you start just to react in what way you see the difference and the similarities, and maybe then Rusty can jump in, maybe just tell our audience what you said yesterday, and then maybe you respond to this Pussy Riot.
Honestly, I don't see much difference actually in our approaches. I think we are on the same page. I would not overemphasize the liturgical, the ritual side of this performance. I don't think people in the Kremlin would care about, you know, the nuances of performance. They are not liturgists, hopefully. But yes, I thank you for emphasizing this feminist side of the performance, which was actually doubled because they prayed to Mary, another female figure. So it was a kind of conversation between women. probably as the recent developments show, that this feminist agenda seems to be, in the Russian at least context, anti-totalitarian, and I like this aspect. There could be exaggerations, like with the Ukrainian group Femen, which used to be famous a few years ago. But yes, I think that, well, I'm very happy that this feminist agenda is here, is very much on the agenda, and has become a token of changes. Has been discussed so much, even on the House of Cards. I think they appeared right in the TV series, the Pussy Riot. So it was a short episode of 5 minutes, and so many people, mainly men, discuss it. That's what I like.
Okay. Rusty, can you jump in on that?
Yeah. I think my wife once said you can go from being the campus liberal to the campus conservative by changing campuses. And clearly the Pussy Riot, their whole mode is to break things open. And by breaking things open and transgressing, you open up new possibilities. And if one is living in a suffocating environment, then that is received, as it was in the European and American context for many decades, is received as a blessing, because it brings a needed freedom. And last night, I made the argument that in the United States, we're drowning in freedom, and we don't need more of it. And in fact, that this fluidity and the breaking of things has become the source of our own social disorder, or our own social disruption in the United States. Also, it's always a sign that something has reached the end of its usefulness when it becomes something that all the great and the good, when rich and powerful people affirm transgression, you know it's no longer actually liberating anybody. And so the fact that Pussy Riot gets lionized in the American press and by, get invited to the White House or whatever, is a sure sign that the function of that sort of behavior in the United States is completely different from what it is in Russia.
Mm-hmm. But you, so if I understood you correctly, you would say it's maybe important as a liberating dimension in Russia, but it would be, it's a very different situation in the United States.
I think actually transgressive art in the United States is a way of maintaining the current regime. Mm-hmm. If the regime is a regime of perpetual weakening and perpetual pushing away of all limits, then anyone who wants to stand up and say, well, wait a minute, surely the different fact that men and women are different has to limit us somehow, that person gets shouted down. And then they're subjected to a kind of, they're subjected to re-education by the officially mandated spokesman for transgression. It's a very different situation. And like I say, all of our major art institutions, all of our major cultural institutions have made transgression into the great artistic expression. So it's the deepest cliche we have in the United States now, transgression, boundaries.
Mm-hmm. Well, I would say that there are different levels in sort of describing and interpreting Pussy Riot case. I took only one aspect that was crucial for the relation between state and the church, the metaphysical aspect of prayer for the power or against power. So I agree that there are different levels. We could discuss it from the from liturgical perspective, of course. We could discuss it from the case how it developed in the court, because the church actually stepped aside from in the court. There were no priests, bishops, theologians there. The representatives from the side of the church.
The accusers were from the church.
The accusers were the guard that was there during the performance and the lady that was selling candles. So there were two representatives, and they were saying really funny things like how these women can dance in the church, because we have the most precious thing that is there. Гвоздика будет.
Nail.
The nail from the cross. And that was really funny, because when we were speaking about the cathedral, the main cathedral of the Russian church, and we're saying that the nail is the most precious and most holy thing in it, in this sort of secular context, it sounds really funny. I'm sorry that we don't have really good description from the very beginning to the end of this of this story.
My question is, if they would have, if they would have, what is the right term, if they would have committed any kind of rule breaking just in liturgical things, so outside politics, and not connecting it to say Mother of God cast out Putin, would that be the same, or is the connection with this very strong political claim?
Yes, I think the main problem is the political claim. Mm-hmm. That's for sure. If the words would be different, the whole thing nobody sort of noticed that.
So as soon as religion enters really central political territory, then there is a crisis. Okay, I've two more questions, and then I will open up. The second question, maybe I'm not well trained enough, but I want to shortly reflect on your use of civil religion. So you mentioned, of course, civil religion. We gained the term, broadly speaking, from Rousseau, and then the modern version of it, Robert Bella. But at least what I have in mind now, in Germany, there was also a discussion after Robert Bella by Hermann Lübbe and others, when they said a civil religion is even a concept you can use to describe the functioning of a democratic state, for instance, without any kind of connection to a denomination, to a real religion. So in some way, a relation of a society, of a state, in Germany, for instance, to the Grundrecht, to the Grundgesetz, to the foundational laws, is civil religion in some way. So my feeling was, when you used now the term civil religion, it was very much connected. As soon as the church entered, then we got civil religion. Maybe. Can you say something on that? I mean, it's a little bit more difficult with the United States because there was always this strong tradition of the democratic regime in the United States coming from religion. It's a little bit more difficult in Europe because the democratic developments very often were against religion, and nevertheless, sociologists use the term civil religion without any interference of a denomination of a church.
Well, I would say civil religion is it articulates the legitimacy of the political system as a whole. Mm-hmm. And political religion is a theologizing of one side in the contest for power. Mm-hmm. And that's why I think progressivism is a political religion. So that, and then again, evangelicals in the United States often theologize the Republican Party's platform as a kind of theological imperative. That if you don't vote for a Republican, you are an apostate, in effect. And there are many conservative Christians who think that way in the United States. But it's equally the case that, as we know from some of the really quite extraordinary things people are saying after the election of Donald Trump, that many progressives regard it as simply impossible for a morally serious person to disagree with them. And so that, in a sense, they're theologizing their own political views. Whereas the civil religion is deep piety that almost all Americans have towards the U.S. Constitution, the Declaration of Independence, that is surrounded also by some sense of the providential design that God, or the Supreme Being, really is using the United States of America to do something new in the world. You know, this experiment in a democracy that somehow springs forth. So I think that's how I see the difference between the two.
Would you like to jump in on that
question? Well, after Bella, a huge volume of literature has appeared on civil religion, such huge that Bella eventually disowned actually the concept of civil. He rejected civil religion and condemned it as a concept, even though it was the most successful thing that he has done. That he did.
Oh, Habits of Heart was a pretty successful
book. This volume is so wide that people applied the concept of civil religion to ancient Rome, ancient Greece, ancient Persia, Middle Ages, whatever. You can India, Persia, China, everything. I would consider it more concisely as a phenomenon of the modern era, of the era of secularism. Civil religion, both civil religion, political religion, are phenomena of the modern secular era. And they actually can lead us to the discussions about secularism, post-secularism, and so forth. They're connected, I believe. That's why I would stay there in the era of in the framework of secularity. That would be my specific.
Well, because I think secularity creates a crisis of legitimacy. And I mean, one reason you have civil religion in the United States, and in that sense, I tried to describe it, is that officially, the legitimacy of the government flows from the will of the majority. But that's just so implausible. I mean, it's so implausible that simply because 51% of people believe X, that therefore X is true or right or good. Nobody thinks about it for very long and really believes that. And so you need then to sort of say, well, yes, but the system that's based on majority rule is itself somehow not divinely sanctioned, because that's, as you get, that's too strong, but somehow it has a kind of sacred quality to it.
That's the famous vox populi, vox Dei. So the voice of the people is like the voice of God.
Yeah, no one really believes that.
Well, but it...
you believe that when the voice of the people agree with you. And when the voice of the people disagree with you, you talk about how the people are ignorant, stupid, and ill-informed, and all that kind of stuff.
But sometimes it's used in the sense when the people agree with what you want to get accomplished politically.
But I think one of the things that I think many Europeans have a hard time grasping about the United States is the depth, and it's starting to fray actually in the United States, but the depth of piety towards our institutions, I think is hard for Europeans to grasp. Because just, you know, how could a secular institution that obviously have an origin in time, the United States Constitution was formulated by representatives from 13 states, ratified in 1787, but it's treated as though it was delivered on Mount Sinai.
Yeah, I would say just a few words. Yes, I think it's quite useful to use this term only for the secular age, but the main point, I think, is it describes the relation of religion or religions with this cooperation of the religions with the secular state. And the American model is very specific, I would say unique. In Europe we have other models, and I think the most interesting model is the new one, which developed during last, say, 15-20 years. That's post-Soviet civil religion. And I think it's quite interesting to sort of to discuss it, but maybe.
Okay, I think we all, or at least I myself feel more clear now how you use the term. Maybe a last question, leading probably to a reflection of your thesis that's also part of the program. I will end with that, but I have to put some oil into the fire here and to have some more disagreement. If I understood Cyril and Rusty correctly, I think your understanding of political religion is not the same. I want to have a little fight on this issue, because if I understood you correctly, you said the shift from civil religion to political religion is an enchantment. This is this type of enchantment, and you were referring, of course, also a little bit to Rusty's talk yesterday, when he says the 20th century was celebrating disenchantment in the Max Weberian sense, and now we have this kind of movements longing for strong gods, for enchantment. And if I understood you correctly, you would say this is a very dangerous shift towards political religion, in the sense Vögelin described it in the 20th century. Rusty probably will say, well, you are got stuck in the 20th century, now there is a good development against political religions, which you now identified with liberalism. So, if I understood you just before correctly, you used the term political religion for the post-Protestant liberal regime.
Right.
That has to be broken, right, by new movements.
Obligatory disenchantment.
Yeah. So, can you jump in a little bit more strongly? So
well, speaking technically about the term of political religion, it is a continental concept.
Yeah.
Fundamental continental. I don't know if it has been ever applied to the American context until today. it described the situation in interwar Germany, particularly, and then applied also to the Soviet Union. It is described the regimes that pretended that they were quasi religious because they had rights, they had charismatic prophets in the leadership, they had an entourage of normal religion. That's why probably in the post-everything era, it's hardly possible to speak about political religion. But I think we can talk about it in a sense. It is a very postmodern version of political religion. Even if we talk about Russia, mm-hmm. what the regime of Putin is fundamentally postmodern. Fundamental, because it combines element of everything. Mm-hmm. It relativizes everything. No stable truths mm-hmm. in this regime. Everything is subordinated to the experience, to the political purpose, including religion, mm-hmm. including political religion. And in this sense, the new political religion is fundamentally postmodern. Mm-hmm. It is different. Yet, the similarity between the classical political religions of the modern era, of the era of ideologies, and the modern post, the contemporary post-ideological regime in Russia, is that both apply violence, both occurs, mm-hmm. and that's my point about
but, religion. But how is it possible, if you understand Putin's political religion as a post-modern version, how is it possible that he presents himself at the same time supported by the Orthodox Church as the fighter for truth against liberal relativism?
Well,
he
is a fighter for post-truth, mm-hmm. not for truth.
Yeah.
That is the difference between.
But he presents himself as someone well, defending truth.
Yes, post-truth does not call itself post-truth.
Yeah.
It mm-hmm. calls itself truth. Mm-hmm. That is the problem mm-hmm. with this.
So, Rusty, what do you think about that? Because Trump is seems also to be a defender of truth, but actually probably more like post-truth and not truth at all.
Alternative facts.
Yeah, alternative facts, as we...
But I think there's a difference between a kind of calculated misinformation, campaign of misinformation, versus the sort of Trumpian hyperbole and disregard for the details. Mm-hmm. I mean, we all know people who when they're challenged in an argument, retreat and fabricate facts. Mm-hmm. We should be worried when we have a kind of consistent line of falsehoods mm-hmm. that are promoted at different levels in his administration. That would be very disturbing, as opposed to his kind of verbal mm-hmm. manner. You know, which outrages. I like because I don't like the obligatory disenchantment. You know, for those goes in the name of political correctness, I'm in favor of a disruptor. Mm-hmm. So he's the Pussy Riot in the American context.
Okay.
Trump.
Okay.
So I'm opening up possibilities.
I mean, the gender is not, does not fit, but I mean, it's an analogy.
Well, I mean, he's opening up possibilities. So a good example was his, he tweeted these, you know, these kind of sharp comments about John Lewis, who was a civil rights leader. Yeah. And so he was attacking a sacred figure. And so there was a taboo to attack a sacred figure. And so that was clearly has to do with our, the way in which the sacred character of our politics, the civil rights movement is a sacred moment. The participants are sacred characters. You don't enter the sanctuary, because if you do, you violate it. And he entered the sanctuary in a particularly Pussy Riot fashion, and he said things that you're not supposed to say in the sanctuary, and people were outraged and inflamed. I think, as an American, that I think that one of the problems we have in racial relations in the United States is we're frozen in 1965, and that if we want to think in a helpful, in a productive way about race in America, we have to break down the sacred character of that moment. So we can actually talk. Right now you can't, no, what a person like myself doesn't talk about race, because if you talk about race, you might touch a sacred object, and you know, just like the sons of just like the sons, who is it that they carry the ark and they wind up dying because they violate it. So you don't want to do that, and so that this has to be. I'm not against, you know, we've inherited certain sacred things. Mm-hmm. In a society that officially denies that there's anything that's sacred.
So, Sergei, do you agree with his interpretation as Putin as a postmodern batch worker?
Yes, I would say that, again, coming, trying to compare civil religion and political religion. Civil religion actually comes from the level of the society and going up to the politics and influences politics.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And political religion goes opposite way, from the political elite down to the society and to the church.
Okay. Shouldn't we ask your thesis as a final round here and then open up for questions?
Yes. So my thesis was, what I really wanted, no one really talked about that part, but just a third question, which what all these relations, what we basically, what does that do to the believers and the grassroots? And I think the reason why I ask this question is because I also come out of a study of religion during the Soviet period, and there's a lot of literature also on and how simple believers during the Soviet period kept up their faith. And I mean, they were completely without any illusions about the KGB involvement and the state controlment of their church. It wasn't actually important, because what was important is that there was a liturgy which they would attend and a faith they would cultivate. And then there were maybe some charismatic priests like Alexander Main who had, you know, an important role, and then people sort of followed him. But I mean, I think actually, and I think there was a polls that show that, even though it's difficult now to trust polls in Russia, but I really think that probably most Russian believers don't care at all about that. Those who are real believers, I mean, who really are Orthodox Christians. I mean, they have no illusions about the political character of their church leadership or about the fake religious character of their political leadership. They don't believe that Putin is a believer. Or maybe they do. So that's in a way the question. So what happens really to the grassroots? How do you assess that? Because I don't know. And you know. You may know. I have more difficulty to ask the same questions for the U.S. because I know the U.S. much less. But maybe, if you listen to the answer from what happens to the real believers in the Russian context, you could also reflect on whether there's a parallel to that phenomenon in the U.S. context.
So, gentlemen, that's a
a last task to do?
Yeah, let me maybe try to start. Well, that's the most difficult question, actually. We don't know how to deal with the concept of unity today. What does that mean that church is united, is Catholic? On one hand, we have this sort of this approach that we know from in Russian context, from the Soviet times, the ideological unity. So that's why I was fired from the Moscow Patriarchate, because I sort of stated that my position is different from the position of the patriarch. And the demand was that no, we should all have the same views, not only on doctrinal issues, but also on the model of church-state relations and etc. This is one thing. The other thing is that we're discussing now, I think, for 15 years, quite actively, how many believers, Orthodox Christians, we have today in Russia. And we have, I would say, sort of 10 different answers from sociologists also. Because the problem today is, sort of explain this problem, that people who were baptized during 90s and later during this period of church revival, they were not educated. They were just baptized. And they have no courses, no catechism, no explanations of in big scale. Of course, there are exceptions, and there are wonderful parishes who prepare the parishioners for baptism, catechumens. I would say dozens of millions were just baptized, and it was supposed that they will become good Christians just because they are Russians or Ukrainians or Slavs or other baptized nations. So it's on the genetic level that they're Christians, and it's very easy, no need for religious education and parish life. So now they are for 10, 15, 20 years in the church, and they say, we are real believers. Our position is the sort of true position of the church. But they're still very Soviet and knows very little about the teachings of the church, even about the gospel. But they do follow the formal rituals and sort of fasting liturgy and so on. So what can we do in this situation? Which voice is the true voice of the church? And the best answer that was found in Russia was, we don't deal with this question at all. The real voice of the church is the voice of the patriarch. That's it. So I have no answer to the question.
Well, you had an answer. Rusty.
I'll hear from my other.
Yes.
Okay.
Well, it's also a difficult question for me. I haven't been to Russia now since 4 years ago. So. But my impression is that all these restrictions that you mentioned, they work and they reshape the social body and the minds of people. They may refrain from politics, they may stay away, at least those who understand what is going on. But that is a minority, a tiny group of people, really, who understand. That is my impression. The majority, they comply with the general line, with the ideology which brings mixed messages. Message of the church is composed nowadays. It consists of the political messages, political elements, and theological, religious elements. People are just unable to distinguish the two kinds of elements, components in this one single message. And this is a problem, and I think that is what I consider my own task, to make a distinction between the political component and the religious component in the message promulgated by the church nowadays. Very hard task for ordinary people.
Okay, Rusty, now no excuse.
Wow. We're social animals. Because we're social animals, we have a strong instinct toward the political. And that instinct can become inflamed, just like our sexual instinct can become inflamed, and that one of the features of the democratic modern age has been to incite in people, to raise people up to the level of political citizenship, which is a great achievement of the modern era. But in doing so, it also elevates the significance and the role of politics for everyone. And that's one reason why in a very strongly democratic culture, the political realm can become quite exaggerated in its rhetoric, and it can draw on religion in ways to try to dramatize its significance, motivate people. And so I think it's always a challenge for religious leaders to remind people of the secondary quality of their political vocation and the primary purpose or the primary role of their religious vocation. And I think that, you know, people succumb to this kind of inflamed political sense. But I wonder how, is it really that big of a problem in the United States? I don't know. For some people, yes, I suppose, but I think most people when they go to church are not thinking about politics.
They are not thinking about politics.
No. Yeah. I mean, when you go to Mass in New York, and when I used to live in Omaha, Nebraska, I don't think I've ever, you can hear occasional sermons on themes that are of current political significance. But by and large, no, that's not the case. And I think there's some evangelical churches that are heavy on politics, but even then, I think usually it's this Bible, 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 Bible. And so there's a danger of being absorbed by the political, but there's a constant attempt to sort of reclaim souls, if you will, from the political to orient them towards their true citizenship in the city of God. So I just think this is what it means to live in the modern democratic age. And it's a challenge the church always has to face in a democratic age.
I mean, there is...
Because we do have duties and responsibilities as citizens.
Yeah. No, sure.
And I don't think that we should say that our Christianity has nothing to do with the political. It does.
Yeah.
It would be bizarre if it didn't. And so it's a spiritual challenge. It's a matter of spiritual discipline to maintain that proper sense of its subordinate role.
Yeah. I mean, one of the most striking things in your most recent books, and maybe it's a last question, a quick question to Ukraine and Russia. One of the most striking things in Rusty's book on the US is that despite that there are much more nuns in the United States, people who do not believe or are not committed to any kind of specific religious self-understanding, so the nuns have increased significantly, but those who attend regularly church, those numbers are quite stable and are still about 25-30%, right?
That's right.
Yeah. So 25-30% regular church attendance or religious service attendance in the United States is for Western countries a very high.
I lived in Omaha, Nebraska for 20 years, and in Omaha on any given Sunday, 50% of people are in church.
Yeah. So that means there is a strong life of church life. So if you look at Austria or the Western countries in Europe, church attendance is far below 15-10%. So it was about 15% 20 years ago when I went for a year to the United States, and I was just surprised to see all those people weekly going to church. So what about Ukraine and Russia? So there is a lot of discussion, religion and politics, but do people go to church, and how many of them?
As you said, ask 10 sociologists to get 11 answers.
No, that's more or less, the answer, the attendance of the church
I think we have roughly, we have 2-3% of those who go to the church every week, so the 5% who go a few times a month, and sort of another 5% goes a few times a year. Mm-hmm. So it's roughly 10% also from sort of 7 to 12. So it correlates, it's the European more or less the same as in Europe.
I think Ukraine is more religious. There is a higher attendance to churches. It's not as high as in Poland.
Yeah,
it's somewhere in between Poland and Russia. Mm-hmm. And exactly, it varies depending on the region. In the western part of Ukraine, there are more churchgoers. Mm-hmm. In the east, there are less. And it's interesting that the religious ideology or religion-based ideology became more prominent in the east, where the church attendance is lower.
Yeah.
So there is. I think there is a correlation. Mm-hmm. The lower is the attendance, the more ideological is religion, the more...
The reason I think is because if you have a very broad base of people participating in the church, then the leadership doesn't control what the religion means.
Exactly.
So Christianity in the United States, I mean, most of the evangelical leaders did not support Trump, but the rank and file supported him very strongly.
Mm-hmm.
And so the political significance of Christianity in America has to do with that 25% and how they behave. And the leaders are important too. I mean, what they say obviously influences politics and so on. But when you have a very small base of people, then the leadership, they speak for the church. And I think that's a situation where they can be co-opted or seduced to make these kinds of agreements.
And the last thing that I wanted to add about Ukraine, coming back to the events of the Maidan, of the Revolution of Dignity, what we call, it was a purely political phenomenon. Well, it was a civil protest, which led to the emergence of the civil society. In this regard, it was a very European phenomenon. But at the same time, it was quite un-European because it expressed itself in religious terms. It was not secular. And the participation of the churches was tremendous in the Maidan. And actually, even though it had a purely political agenda, there were prayers, and there were probably the most massive prayers in Europe, when thousands of people just stood on their knees, kneeled on the frozen pavement and prayed together. And it was a huge ecumenical event as well, because the churches that normally hate each other, they came together and actually worked together, the Maidan. In this sense, the Maidan, even though it was a civil protest, leading to emergence of the civil religion, of the civil society, excuse me, it was charged religiously heavily.
Okay, thank you. So, your patience was already tremendous, but whatever question you want to address to one of our three experts, I'm happy to invite you and no longer put my own questions first. I mean, I have some more questions if you are not...
May I add to the last question a little bit?
Okay.
I would like to keep it short, but nevertheless, you mentioned this messianistic impulse in the United States and in Russia, and you even described it, are there really parallels? Aren't there many more differences between this messianistic impulse in the United States and in Russia? Because in Russia you have got this very abstract idea of saving, no idea of who, the whole world, and in the United States it's rather, you described it very well, it's rather connected to enlightenment.
Mm-hmm. May I start, actually? Yeah. I think that's I'm thinking a lot about that. I think the main problem between these two types of messianism in the 21st century is that the ideals that the idea that America has it somehow rooted in the sort of political and public life. And the ideal that we have is more sort of, in the literature, in sort of general words about salvation and generals and sort of general vision, how it should be. So when people ask me, so what is your idea? I say, I'm sorry, we can't put it in a few words. That will take sort of a few hours to explain, and we will not sure that you will understand. So that's the problem now, that we have more, that this messianic idea in Russia is more a feeling, an emotion, and not something articulated and I would say practical.
You wouldn't say it's, I mean, come on, you could say that it's subornos versus social contract.
Well,
a social contract, how can you possibly have a humane society based on a contract versus genuine unity?
Well,
that's
right,
spiritual,
but
spiritual in character.
You see, but we're speaking about subornist, but we have autocratic state, and we have the church with the strongest hierarchical structure, even in comparison with the Catholic Church.
But I just think that, so if we see today a kind of Putinism presenting itself to right-wing Europeans as a leader, that seems to me to be, it follows in that tradition of saving Europe from its spiritual poverty. That, so it can play into that. Whereas I can't imagine Romanians adopting this view, or for that matter, the French. I mean, the French are—they seem similar to America because it's Enlightenment. But I've discovered that an American thinks that if you strip away everything, you'll find an American. Whereas a Frenchman believes everyone is ultimately destined to be a Frenchman, but it's going to take a lot of work to get them up to that level. So only a few people are actually blessed to have been born in France and therefore attain the universality of being Frenchman. So it's really quite different. So French don't have that same messianic zeal that Americans have. But I think it's not coincidental. There's something about the Russian self-understanding and its role in history that would allow for this Putinism to, he would exploit in an opportunistic way, but can draw on a tradition.
Well, I think you can interpret this in terms of the empires that existed. And empires are still effective. They still shape people. If you take British Empire, it vanished, but still some kind of imperial thinking prevails. There is a Russian imperialism, or neo-imperialism. What we have in Putinism is just an imperialism, neo-imperialism, I think, and it's a new neo-Soviet project. That's why Putinism considers the United States as another imperial project, and it's just a rival of two empires for him. So he still thinks, his thinking is exactly the framework of old-style imperialism. And what is lacking in Russia, and I'm really an advocate of Russian nationalism. Sometimes Putinism is confused with nationalism, but they are opposite. Nationalism is a threat to Putinism. And if Russia was a national state, we would not have these neo-imperial paroxysms and revivals. This sort of imperialism should not be confused with universalism, which is Christian, really, a Christian merit. It's not a merit of empires. And it tries to dress up as a Christian messianic kind of thing to converse the entire world into conservatism, which is a utopia, and even they understand it is impossible. Essentially, what they do is to divide the world into conservatives and liberals. As they do within Russia, they have divided the society, the single body of people, into conservatives and liberals, and play with conservatives. They do the same worldwide. They try to widen, to deepen the divide within the American society, in the European societies, and they try on both sides right, ultimate right, radical right and radical left. They play successfully with both irreconcilable sides. And their task is to divide people, not to bring them together, what the empires do. That is a radical difference between Putinism and the universal message of the church, which is uniting, really.
I have an example that connects very good to what you just outlined. There, I don't see any hand, so I read my example, but I think it's an interesting thing and brings the question of Russia and the United States in a new framework. So I'm quoting from an article by David Brooks, Bannon versus Trump from the New York Times, January 10th of this year. And he makes an interesting comparison between Donald Trump's ideologist, Stephen Bannon, who is responsible for media communication and comes from the, what is the?
Breitbart.
Breitbart media, or Breitbart, what is it called?
So,
news.
Yeah.
News.
The website.
Website, yeah. And Putin's ideologist, Alexander Dugin. And it's like going back to 20th century, Brooks writes, and reading two versions of Marxism. So one is American Christian and the other is Orthodox Russian. But both have grandiose sweeping theories of world history. Both believe we are in an apocalyptic clash of civilizations. Both seamlessly combine economic, moral, and political analysis. Both self-consciously see themselves as part of a loosely affiliated international populist movement, including the National Front, Front National in France, Nigel Farage in Britain, and many others. Dugin wrote positively about Trump last winter, and Bannon referred to Dugin in his Vatican remarks. So, quote, "We must create strategic alliances to overthrow the present order of things," Dugin has written, "of which the core could be described as human rights, anti-hierarchy, political correctness, everything that is the face of the beast, the Antichrist. We, the Judeo-Christian West, really have to look at what Putin is talking about as far as traditionalism goes," Bannon said, "particularly the sense of where it supports the underpinnings of nationalism." So is there this kind of ideological similarities between thinkers behind Trump and thinkers behind Putin, Dugin? And I'm a little get nervous when I read such things, because at least I know that Dugin is a careful reader of Carl Schmitt, who is a dangerous thinker, although some of his analyses have to be taken seriously. But nevertheless, it's a dangerous thing. I don't know if there is a, don't know yet if there is a link between Bannon and Carl Schmitt, but at least some of the circles are interested not only in the analytical insights of Schmitt, but also on his normative recommendations, which I don't recommend, actually.
Well, if you look at, Bannon gave a speech at the Vatican, or interview.
Yeah, that's very cool.
Right. And it's basically a kind of popularized version of John Paul II, which is that, capitalism and liberal social norms taken alone are anti-human. And one gets that in Dugin also. So that's a stream. So when I read Dugin, I underlined some of the passages that I said, sounds like a First Things author, so we have to recognize that there's a tradition of dissent from modernity. There's a tradition of modern dissent from modernity's own modernity's project, of which the Catholic Church has got a long line of people. whether it's Etienne Gisson and his, you know, tracing it all back to nominalism, which is a kind of philosophical error, or for that matter, the young Jacques Maritain. And so there's a long tradition of critiques of modernity. And I see Bannon fitting into that tradition, which is not just T.S. Eliot, there's another one.
Chesterton, probably.
G.K. Chesterton, Eliot, in the United States, Alan Tate, Richard Weaver, Richard Weaver, Russell Kirk. And there's a long tradition in the United States of, and in England, and on the continent, Ortega y Gasset. So there are many people that have had forebodings and fears about the trajectory of modernity. And I put, you know, Bannon and Dugin into that tradition. You know, and the question is, well, what does one do, you know? And I mean, again, the United States is a traditionally liberal nation. So that when someone is worried about losing our tradition, you know, this is always the curse of being a conservative of America, is you wind up circling back and affirming the very principles that have given rise to the things that you don't like. and so it's also a great guard against extremism.
I mean,
not that from what little I know about Dugin, that's not true in his case, where he does entertain, you know, quite radical forms of a restoration of authority.
Wouldn't the question, and following up a little bit on Cyril, be, I mean, I have a lot of sympathy for profound critiques of modernity, like Chesterton, Ortega y Gasset, and so on. So I have a lot of sympathy. I'm always suspicious when then those, or now people like Dugin or Bannon, they may be in some way in line with those profound critiques of modernity, but what they support politically is probably the same thing as we have to criticize from a profound point of view.
But so I think one of the polling suggests that young people in America do not think free speech is a fundamental right. So whatever the regime is, the cultural, political regime that has been predominant, is giving rise to its own kind of liberalism. So someone like Bannon, I don't think he qualifies as a thinker. Mm-hmm. So I think it's unwise to suggest that he has developed views on anything. But his intuition seemed to be of deep concern that the trajectory on which we are currently on is going to lead to illiberalism. The current system needs to be fought against precisely for the sake of preserving the best achievements of modernity.
Very brief. I think my position regarding Dugin is very simple. First, he draws on Carl Schmitt, certainly, but he should not be put on the same scale with Carl Schmitt. I think he resembles not politische Theologie by Schmitt, but he is closer to Mein Kampf. Mm-hmm. And he actually advocates, he tries to resurrect actually the spirit of Hitler. His strategy is not to produce, to be a thinker. His strategy is to provoke, to get people stuck in him, to stuck in his writings, to discuss his writings. And he's a madman and he's a dangerous man, I believe. Okay. He's not like Carl Schmitt. Carl Schmitt was a difficult personality, but much nicer than Dugin.
May I just quick follow up? I was at a conference about 6 months ago, and there was a German political scientist who gave a paper on Dugin, and he said Dugin is very anti-American. So, but now he's supporting Trump. So
for the same reason.
Sorry, Christina.
Yes, I also wanted to just come in because I very much agree with, you know, Cyril's judgment on Dugin. And what actually really puzzles me is that I'm also fond of, you know, profound critiques of modernity, and I think, you know, we have to study these critiques much more. But I think these critiques, which we study seriously, should guard us from taking at face value people like Dugin, who are real dangers. Because obviously every critique has the risk of turning violent and extremist, and he has given so much proof of that. So, I just wanted to say that because I think, you know, I don't want put Dugin to be mentioned and this not being clear.
We should not mention him?
No, I think if you mention him, then I think it's very... I mean, also maybe people in the audience who don't know that. I mean, you know, Dugin is not a Chesterton no.
Yeah,
but he can write in First Things or immediately.
I could say your underlying passages. He's got kind of, obviously, from what I've read, a kind of magpie mind that picks up this, that, and the other thing. And in that sense, he's... The attention-getting desire is very postmodern. A lot of left-wing postmodernism. Zizek strikes me as a kind of left-wing version, more innocent perhaps, less malign, but similar. Provocateur picks up wherever you can find something.
Yes.
To, you know, saying things for effect without really real consideration for consistency.
But I think we have good reasons to deal with that. We just need intellectual sincerity and coherence. And if we read these authors with intellectual sincerity and coherence, then we will discard them. Like, I'm not a fan of Zizek, you know? So...
Well, Zizek is harmless. I mean,
yes, yeah, maybe...
He's a kid. Dugin is not a kid, he's a monster.
Yeah, the problem is that Dugin is writing sort of for the last 30 years thousands pages per year, so I think you can't read all this, all his words, and I guess that he's changing his mind, at least from time to time. Mm-hmm. He started, I would say, 30 years ago as a traditionalist in René Guénon style. He followed different conspiracy theories. Then he turned to the concept of conservative revolution. Then he became a sort of orthodox but very special type, a sort of old right parish within the Moscow Patriarchate. So, but very sort of strict and sort of very, very old fashioned, not just traditionalistic. And then he started to play with Kremlin. It seems that sometimes he really did have some connections. We don't know what happens today, but you definitely can't say that Dugin somehow connected to the decision-making process in Kremlin. Mm-hmm. For sure not. But, well, we don't know. I think there are a few figures like that. In 2000, Nikita Mikhalkov was very close to Putin and had some influence, but we don't really know what kind of influence that was.
So you would put in question David Brooks'
yes,
thesis that Dugin is
right.
The ideologist of Putin.
Exactly.
That's
yeah.
Exactly.
Walter LeCour's book on Putin from a year or two ago said that Dugin had no influence. But I would say this, reading him, and I only read one book, and that's the only book I'm inclined to read, one samples. When push comes to shove, he is very postmodern in the sense that the new future is going to come from below. Some dark powers are going to emerge and rise, and he's quite explicit about that. But it's fascinating that for somebody like Derrida, or more explicitly for Michel Foucault, it's the same thing. There's some kind of dark, these are dark, uncertain powers now for Difference. Well, what is difference? Difference is the sort of surging world of possibility. It was underneath everything, surging to the top, creating the possibility of life. And for Foucault, it's more explicitly the powers of sex and death and biopower and things like that. So whatever you two don't like in him is very much part of, has been very much part of our intellectual culture for the last generation. Now we domesticate it in all kinds of ways, but it's waiting to be exploited.
Well, but neither Foucault nor Derrida said explicitly that, say, Ukrainians should be exterminated or the Americans should be
it's a sign of the kind of exhaustion it's a sign of the exhaustion of the modern project. You can't find a principle of life within itself.
I don't agree. He meant it.
He meant what?
When he said kill,
no, I'm not,
on about Ukraine, he meant it.
I don't doubt it. I'm not, he's not a thinker, as you pointed out. He's a kind of provocateur and a dangerous one, and I fully accept that. But I'm only pointing out that our culture, our intellectual culture in the West has put seeds out that are available for bad people to pick up and use, because we don't actually have little thin things like human rights that have no actual metaphysical foundations we can articulate in a convincing way to each other.
But if you put Dugin so close to a thinker like Derrida, I would also completely protest against that, because if you you don't have to agree, and we don't have to say that Derrida is a real answer to our problems. But if you read him carefully, you see he's very much aware of violence in all different varieties. So difference is just don't fix the system, don't close it up, don't turn into violence. So to have this very fine sensibility for all these dangers of modern violence, to put on the same level as someone who.
But we're going to be saved by something. We're going to be saved by this something that's below reason, underneath it, not above. I mean, so yes, I mean, I agree. He's a very humane man. I don't dispute that, and I take your word that Dugin is a very inhumane man. But the fact of the matter is that for Derrida, there's no, I mean, it's ultimately, the only thing we have is, it's the id, the incalculable, impossible, unknowable percolation, flux of reality underneath what we imagine to be the truths that we are loyal to.
Maybe that's true too, I, as a theologian, my answer to those problems is not the same.
Happy nihilisms, and you've got unhappy nihilisms.
No, but let me conclude. My response to those problems is not the same as Derrida. But I think, as a theologian who is committed, for instance, to the broader Catholic or Christian doctrine, I think we have to learn from people like Derrida, because they show us that when we talked about things above or higher things, that we sometimes mix them up with violence, with coercion in a terrible way. And so one of the reasons why those thinkers who are so aware of the dangers of violence no longer talk about the things high above, but solutions from below or some kind of silent messianism, has to tell us a little bit about our own theology, how we have to reflect on our own tradition, where we got it wrong. You may disagree, of course, but I think that's...
As I said, if nothing is worth fighting for, nobody will fight. It turns out not to be true, actually.
I agree with that, but okay. Christina reminded me of time, and your patience is overdone already completely, but I'm very great. We are all very grateful, first of all, for our speakers, for Christina to convene that together, and for you to following our discussion, which brought many interesting and important things up on the table. So thank you very much for our speakers, and have a nice evening.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.